So we will continue what we were trying to understand last in the last session, right? So I have few more slides to show you for the deformation behavior and texture related thing. The microstructure means the metallurgist point of view. So you say you see that whenever a material is deformed, with the increase in the strain, there is an increase in the average misorientation value inside the grain. Okay. So, the misorientation angle. Say you can consider this as an average misorientation angle of a cell or a substructure. Okay, it increases. You see that this is an evidence in case of, I think, aluminium or copper, aluminium and nickel. Okay. So, you see this is the geometrically necessary dislocations in square open and closed cell, and you see that with the increase in the strain, how the average misorientation of the GNBs increases. At the same time, you can see that the average misorientation of the IDBs, open and closed circles, so these are square and these are circles, it increases. And this implicates that with the increase in the strain, so when we keep on deforming the material, basically the average misorientation of dislocations which are present in form of SSDs, of course it will convert itself into IDBs, and GNBs which forms due to lattice curvature or different stress tensors in different regions of the grain increases. And this indicates basically that the cell or the subgrain size decreases, if you think on the other way, right? So if you see the misorientation angle with respect to different components, means the texture components, you will see that, see, this is the triangle is the brass component, the square is the copper, round is the gauze, the diamond is the S, the open square is the cube, and you see that as the true strain is increasing, the misorientation on an average is increasing, but the misorientation angle, for example, for the copper component, you see, is the highest. And I can tell you that the deformation component, whenever we deform an FCC material, the slip based deformation component is the copper component, right? So it has the highest strain energy incorporated into it, and therefore it has the highest misorientation angle. On the other hand, you can say smallest cell or the subgrain structure. As we go below, you can see that for the brass, which is basically representing the texture formation due to twin base deformation, that occurs in low stacking fault energy, right? And that is more related to a recovered kind of microstructure, not recovered, basically a recrystallized kind of microstructure, because you know, I don't know whether you know or not, when the deformed grain twins, the twins contain very low strain energy, right? The dislocation content in the twin is very less. It's, if you consider a twin part or a twinned area of the microstructure, that area could be considered like a recrystallized grain. The point is, you see that low strain energy or the low stored energy portions of the microstructure contains misorientation angle, average misorientation angle, which is lower. So the cell and the subgrain structure and or the misorientation of this cell and subgrain is a function of grain orientation, right? So you have deformation, deformation gain. So, the cell and the subgrain size or the misorientation of this cell and subgrain is a function of grain orientation, and the grain orientation is what? For example, if the grain is oriented based on the deformation, so the grain contains a deformation texture, so it has a average misorientation which is higher, or you can say the average misorientation of the subgrain cell boundaries are higher. Here when we are talking, see, when microstructurist or the metallurgist talks subgrain cells, many a times they refer all low angle boundaries inside the grain. Okay. So sometimes it is confusing. It is confusing for me also sometimes. So what I am saying, that whenever this subcell or subgrain structure or even the misorientation of GNDs or cell blocks, or you can say micro shear band, whatever it increases, right, those orientations which are deformation orientation, deformation texture, for that the average misorientation is higher. And if the average misorientation is higher, then the cell or the subgrain sizes are basically lower. On the other hand, for those orientations which are recovered orientation, like the brass, the gauss, the cube, mainly the cube you see, they all have those orientation which have lower strain energy, always have lower misorientation angle for a particular strain, and therefore have a larger cell structure. The shape of the cell structure, though I am not showing here, also changes depending upon which crystallographic plane you are viewing. You know, a deformed plane, a 111 plane for an FCC, may have a little elongated cell structure too. Okay. So you see, here is an example of aluminum 1% magnesium, and the misorientation has been plotted with respect to the true strain, which is increasing, and you see the cell interior has been shown, that is the IDBs has been shown to be having a constant misorientation. On the other hand, the cell band boundaries are also shown to be constant up to a strain of about 2.5 or something. However, the micro shear band boundaries are basically increasing. So we saw few slides before that with the increase in strain, a strain of 1 or 2, the micro shear bands starts to occur, which crosses this cell band kind of structures at 90 degrees, almost at 90 degree, making an S type of structure, right? And this basically is fragmenting, is a kind of a fragmentation inside the grain, right? So you, what we are doing is that we are producing more substructures which are of smaller and smaller size inside the grain with the increase in the strain. So the point is, you see, that stored energy is a function of dislocation density, right? And dislocations are inhomogeneously distributed as cell and substructure. So the assumption while we are talking all this is that a microstructure is present in which there are many grains. In the grain there are dislocations, and these dislocations are arranged in such a way that there are high dislocation density areas and low dislocation density areas. The high dislocation density areas are dislocation cell boundaries, and the low dislocation density areas are the densities, dislocations which are present inside this cell or the subgrain structure. So you see, if the deformed microstructure consists of an well defined equiax subgrains, right, then the stored energy per unit volume, which is given by ES, is equal to the specific energy of the low angle boundary which comprises of the subgrain walls multiplied by the circumference of the cell or the subgrain, that could be 4 pi r square, where r is the radius of the cell or subgrain, divided by the volume. So, this becomes equal to 3 times gamma s by r. Now, the point is the boundary of a subcell is shared by two subcell, right. So, a boundary area, not the line, area of a subcell is basically shared by two subcell. So, it is basically this has to be divided by 2, because this sub grain boundary area is being shared by 2 subgrains. Therefore, this value has to be divided by 2, and thereby this is 3 gamma s by d. D is the diameter of the subgrain. The point is the stored energy per unit volume which is associated with the deformation is almost equal to some constant alpha, which is near to 3 by 2 times gamma, which is the specific energy of that geometrically necessary dislocation, divided by the radius of that cell. So, what we understood is that the stored energy is basically proportional to the So, this specific energy of the GNBs should be basically proportional to the misorientation. The misorientation theta, if increases, the energy of that misorientation grain boundary or the boundary increases, right. We all know that with the increase in the theta, the energy of the boundary increases, and then after a certain high angle boundary, it becomes constant, which is basically considered to be a 15 degree boundary. So, stored energy is basically proportional to the misorientation angle of the low angle boundaries, and inversely proportional to the size of them, right, size of the sub boundaries, sub grain boundaries, right. So, we can see here is an example of a 70% rolled iron, and you can see that it has been shown with the increase in strain. You see, this is a strain for 60%, this is for the 70%, two rolling reductions have been shown, and you can see that the misorientation angle basically increases with respect to these orientations. And you see that this is the 100 orientation, this is 112, this is the 111, then 110 orientation. And you can see that as the these orientations are basically deformation components of the texture, and these are basically the recrystallized components, and you can see that the misorientation angle increases. At the same time, if you see the cell size basically decreases, and these shows the relationship with the stored energy. So, we have higher stored energy associated with these components, so the cell structure or the size is smaller, the misorientation is larger, and as these components are associated with low strain energy, and therefore, they have a larger cell structure and a lower misorientation. This could be also seen when we plot stored energy versus these angles, and you calculate that stored energy in terms of Taylor factor, and you see that whenever, and this Taylor factor is with respect to that particular slip system in which the deformation is supposed to happen, and this Taylor factor is also with respect to the type of deformation. For example, in this case could be the rolling reduction, that is a plane strain compression type, right. So, based upon that, when we calculate the Taylor factor, we found that this component has the highest Taylor factor and this component has the lower Taylor factor. What does it indicate is that these components are not deformed components, whereas a high Taylor factor components basically indicate that these are fully deformed component, means these are an end orientation has reached. So, you see that if the initial microstructure contains few grains with a low Taylor factor orientation, after the deformation, those grains which have the highest Taylor factor are basically the deformed grains. So, it should be associated with the high amount of stored energy. So, you see that when we go from those texture components which are basically recrystallized texture component or other texture component, we have low Taylor factor. When we go to that deformation texture component, we have high Taylor factor. At the same time, if you observe the subgrain sizes inside the TEM using a TEM, we can observe that the stored energy of this subgrains increases with the increase in the deformation component. So, as we go towards the deformation texture, we have higher stored energy, and this could be also confirmed from the X-ray Fourier analysis, and that is it in regard to the deformation texture and the metallurgist point of view. Okay. So, understanding this part is very important. You can continue. Understanding of this part is very important, because you see whenever the material is deforming, the stored energy in the material is increasing. The stored energy of this material is basically conserved in some part of the microstructure. Those part of the microstructures are basically where the deformation has took place the maximum, right? And those part of the microstructure will possess the deformation texture. The part of the microstructure which are away from the deformation texture could be those areas where deformation initially took place, but later it recovered or recrystallized, and therefore, its orientation changes. The change in the orientation from the deformed to the recrystallized component is associated with the decrease in the stored energy, and this decrease in the stored energy is in relationship with the rotational change in the orientation with respect to something, some axis, some crystallographic axis. So you see that whenever the material will recrystallize, its texture most of the time will change. Either it will change with respect to the deformation texture, or it will sometimes it will remain the same. It's a rare case. Yes, it can sometimes it may become random. We will come to that. Okay. So, it is important to understand the theory of annealing texture evolution then. So, when the cold deformed microstructure, say a polycrystalline metal is taken, it is rolled, and then the microstructure, if we look from the transverse direction, will look like this, elongated grains. And let us say we have kept it at some temperature for annealing, some maybe at a lower temperature such that immediately no effect of annealing could be observed directly. So maybe there are lots of dislocations which are present during the deformation. At low temperature, if we keep, it starts to recover, and we understand a little that recovery is a process in which dislocations which are tangled together, arranged, come together to form some dislocation boundaries, regions of high dislocation density and low dislocation density, cell subgrain structure, again and again I am saying. And this is the process of recovery, and you see that during the process of recovery, the strength of the material do not change. You see the hardness is also plotted. So, you see the strength and the hardness do not change. This is the recovery. And then if you see that the ductility also remains almost the same, it does not change much. Thereafter, recrystallization process takes place. So, if you anneal it further, if you keep at that temperature for more hours, slowly when the recovery process is complete, small nucleation of grains takes place at those regions where there are high dislocation densities, where there is high strain energies. Initially it will nucleate at grain boundaries like triple junctions, and you can see small nucleated grains, and this is a process of nucleation. So, the recrystallization has started, and thereafter you see when it is recrystallizing, slowly the strength decreases whereas the ductility increases. Further, if you keep it for longer time, it will start to grow. The new nucleated recrystallized grains are growing. So, you see here also the strength remains constant and ductility slightly increase and become constant. The point is that recovery is a process in which the overall dislocation density remains the same, right? But it gets arranged. It gets arranged. So initially it is all over tangled, and now it is at positions where there is high dislocation density and low dislocation density. And thereafter, what happens? New nucleation of grains takes place. The new nucleation of grains basically it reduces the amount of low angle boundaries present in the microstructure and converts them into high angle boundaries, right? And this leads to lower down the strength so little bit. This is the strength regarding dislocation density is reducing. So, the combined effect is the strength increase due to the Hall Pace relations remains unaffected by the reduction in the strength reduction due to reduction in the dislocation density, right? The point is that with further growth of the grain, this growth of grain is not that substantial to see the Hall patch relationship again. Okay. So, if we go ahead, here is a pictorial representation of the how the recovery takes place. Initially dislocations are tangled, slowly regions of high dislocation density and low dislocation density starts to develop, and then you find that rest of the dislocations get annihilated, and then you get this kind of cell structure which organizes itself to form subgrains, and you see that when it starts to form sharper subgrain boundaries, we call it subgrains, and then the subgrain may start to grow. Kahn et al. In 1949 have shown this process in terms of polygonization, which you might have read in lots of your literature. You see, there are lots of dislocation present, right? These dislocations may come together and annihilate or come together to increase its misorientation, right? So, you see what happens, that once the annihilation process takes place, there are less dislocations, and after the dislocation annihilation, if the dislocation gets arranged like this, a formation of tilt boundaries. Very importantly, it is to understand that these tilt boundaries usually have misorientations which are lower or nearby 1 degrees, right? So, these kind of dislocations which arranging to form tilt boundaries are basically the formation of incidental dislocation boundaries, and this is represented in one of the papers. I forgot to mention the reference. In case of aluminium deformed 10% at 250 degree centigrade, you see that cell structure has developed, and annealing in situ inside the TEM, you see that the cell structure, slowly the substructure get more refined and become subgrain, right. This process could be further shown, like, you know, from the initial again the deformed state where there are more dislocations present, these are dislocation tangled together, and then polygonization where the subgrain formation could be shown in the larger screen, scale, it looks like this, right, with further annealing process. So, we are all talking about static annealing process where new nucleation of grains takes place in the grain boundaries and in regions where there is high dislocation density, which grows to form a fully recrystallized grain, right. The microstructure looks like this. So, we have this recovery process, nucleation, recrystallization, and then the growth, and this whole process consisting of these 5 microstructure is basically known as recrystallization, static annealing and recrystallization, right. And then one can have in some material, if you keep the material at higher temperature or for longer duration, an abnormal grain growth where certain grain grows, and we can call it a secondary recrystallization process. So, you see that whenever we have a deformed microstructure, a deformed microstructure may consist of those grains which are largely deformed and those grains which are deformed less. So, the color of this grain is like that. If you have a dark color, those grains are deformed more, and lighter color grains are deformed less. So, when we anneal this microstructure, the dislocations which are present in the microstructure arrange themselves to form low angle boundaries, and then those arrange themselves to form high angle. And for the highly strained grains, you can see that the grain recrystallized as if it is a continuous dynamic recrystallization. We cannot see the nucleation and the growth stages. So, it is all already like this. But for the low strained material, you can see nucleated grains at different positions, and these nucleated grains show as if it is a discontinuous dynamic recrystallization, right. Now, a nucleation of recrystallization is a very critical factor in terms of both size and orientation, that whether means that nucleation will occur or not. a classical nucleation, which is the Vollmer-Baker theory of nucleation, states that a nucleation during annealing process, a nucleation at a certain position will occur if the stored energy of the newly nucleated grain is equal to or less than the stored energy of that area which is previously present. So, the nucleated stored energy of the nucleated grain, the free energy of the nucleated grain includes the free energy of inside the grain plus the free energy of the new boundaries being created should be less than the boundaries which are present there or the total free energy of the grains of that microstructural area which was present before the formation of this new grain, right. So, this is basically the classical nucleation. Now, you see that there are other nucleation method, recrystallization method, they call it the preformed nucleus or the subgrain growth model. So, I am trying to show you that what different ways a nucleation may occur within a microstructure, right. One is the classical nucleation. The classical nucleation occurs when the newly formed small nucleus can only sustain if its free energy, that is the free energy including the boundary of the newly formed nucleus, is less than the free energy of the deformed structure which was present earlier. On the other hand, the preformed nucleus or the subgrain growth model states that a grain may have orientation variation as shown here, like 1, 2, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 3, 1, 2, 0, 1, something like that. So, you think that each part of that grain contains misorientation which is slightly varied from the the neighboring subgrain. So, you can say that maybe you can think that it is like a deformation band or it can be a cell band structure with little different in the orientation from each other. And when it recovers, what it happens is that you get 1, 2 and 3, 1, 3 and 2 types of grains. So, you see you get within a grain a recovered microstructure with 3 different orientation with means 3 different oriented subgrain structure. But if you have if you have a deformed grain which has an orientation 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, 12, 16 like that, and you can see that the orientation from 1 to 16 may be 2 different, but between 1 and 2, 2 and 4 the misorientation is not that, right. So, these are all subgrains which are present inside the grain, but from one end to another the orientation difference or the misorientation is very high. When it will recover, so it will average out to form one substructure and another substructure and another substructure with, you see, the orientation difference quite more, 1, 9 and 15, and thereby the misorientation between this substructure will not be low, it will be high and may be high as grain boundary, and thereby it may not be a substructure, it may be a grain, right. So, we will not be able to see the nucleation thing, but we will see that instead of one grain, now there are 3 grains present, right. There are other methods of nucleation of the grain. A very important one, strain induced boundary migration. And see, if you have 2 grains and there will be a boundary in between them, and as we know that deformation leads to inhomogeneous stored energy in the microstructure. So, in some grain it will be more, some grain it will be less, and so if the stored energy in grain 2 is higher than the stored energy of the grain 1, then the subcell size will be smaller, the misorientation angle will be larger here, and here it will be larger subcell or the subgrain size, and the misorientation angle will be also smaller. So, you see by the process of diffusion the grain boundary will migrate towards the larger dislocation density area that is in grain 2, and thereby a bulging will be created. This bulge in the grain leads to formation of a new nucleus, that is the nucleation of a recrystallization grain during deformation, by further increasing the misorientation in this side, in the other side, by interaction with other dislocations, right. So, you see this kind of behavior leads to strengthening of cube component, that is 100001 texture during recrystallization of aluminum alloy at high temperature. Okay. So, it can be concluded from this discussion that if the initial deformation is less and the annealing temperature is high, then discontinuous recrystallization may occur or could be observed. And if the deformation is large, then at low annealing temperatures also continuous recrystallization is the case, right. So, discontinuous recrystallization is nothing but, continuous recrystallization is nothing but where we cannot observe the formation of the new nucleus, right. So, here is an example just to show you that this is a rolled aluminum Fe manganese, the strain is 3.9 and this is a cold rolled one, and if we anneal this at low temperature, okay, so 300 degree centigrade, and we observe a microstructure which becomes like this with slight variation from this. And you see that there is no major grain boundary movement. So, there is no recognizable nucleation and growth grains. Microstructure evolves relatively homogeneously throughout the material. You see this and this microstructure is almost the same. However, if the strain is low, 0.69, and even if we did annealing at 250 degree centigrade, which is lower than that, then what happens that the microstructure that is formed consists of smaller grains, necklace kind of structure, which these grains are nucleated during the static recrystallization process. So, this process basically in the literature is known as discontinuous dynamic recrystallization. So, this is all about static recrystallization. What happens when we deform the material and there is a dynamic recrystallization? One can see the stress strain curve that when the material basically dynamically recover during the deformation, what happens that initially after the elastic stress and strain, the material starts to strain harden, and you see the strain hardening peak curve plot. As the material is strain hardening, the strain hardening rate of the material decreases. It is very important to understand that the initially when the material is fully under annealed condition, the larger rate of strain hardening could occur, right. And once the material is strain hardened, then further strain hardening is little difficult or sluggish, and so it eases. So, there is a decrease in the slope, and at the same time what happened after that, what happened, it becomes the strain hardening become constant. So, the strain hardening rate basically becomes 0. So, at this moment what is happening, the amount of dislocation that is being produced during the deformation process is annihilated or consumed because of the formation of the subgrain and the subcell boundaries. So, there is an annihilation of dislocation and the formation of subcell and subcell grain boundary. This is known as the process of recovery. You see the dislocation density becomes constant, the grains elongate. So, some of the dislocations are basically used to elongate the grains, right. So, subgrain remains equiaxed, its size remains constant, its misorientation becomes constant. So, this process of recovery, we always will get a stress strain curve which is straight like this. In case of dynamic recrystallization, mostly discontinuous dynamic recrystallization, what happens that if we observe from low temperature to high temperature, of course, the elastic yield strength and all decreases as we go to the higher temperature. We see the curve, we see that there is a hump and then it is a decrease and then it is a straight line. You see that this hump, you see there is a multiple dynamic recrystallization that is occurring at higher temperature. In these case, what is happening is that initially there is a strain hardening, a decrease in the strain hardening rate, followed by a constant, a little constant, which reflects that the strain hardening rate is basically 0. So, it goes to the, if we plot the strain hardening rate, so initially if this is strain hardening, initial strain hardening occurs like this, it decreases, it comes to 0 and then it becomes constant. During this process, where dynamic recrystallization has started, not only the material is recovering, but also new grains are forming. The new grains could be formed as a necklace kind of a structure, like this is an example of discontinuous dynamic recrystallization. So, a necklace kind of structure forms, and then after some time, when sufficient dynamic recrystallization has taken place, these newly formed grains basically start to deform. These are softer, right? Newly formed grains, no dislocations in it, or very less, only SSDs are present, and therefore, softer grains will deform much firmly than the initially present deformed grains, which is hard now because of the presence of large amount of dislocations. So, once again the dislocation density starts to increase, what will happen? There is a I made one mistake. So, after that there is a recovery. When the theta is 0, that means when the dislocation density becomes constant, as I showed here, when the dislocation density becomes constant, when the true stress becomes constant, that is the amount of dislocation produced and is annihilated is equal, and that time the d sigma by d epsilon becomes 0, and thereafter new grain starts to nucleate, forming a necklace kind of structure, and thereafter softening of the material starts to take place. Okay. So, the material starts to soften. So, with the increase in the strain, the stress basically is decreasing. So, you have more nucleation, the nucleation of new grains leads to strain free nucleated new grains, softer new grains, leading to softening, and thereby the strain hardening rate basically increases. Once after some amount of strain, you see there is another minima present here. The minima is a position where the material now is like, you know, fighting, like a dynamic recrystallized new grains are forming, at the same time they are being deformed. the initial ones are being deformed. So, it is a fighting that whether the total amount of dislocations are decreasing. So, one, the deformation is increasing the amount of dislocation, the dynamic recrystallization is decreasing the amount of dislocation, it is the addition of these two. Till this point, the dislocation, total dislocation is decreasing. And once it reaches this point, the deformation mechanism takes over. So, what happens? The dislocation, total dislocation are again start to increase, leading to again decrease in the strain hardening rate. And this process could repeat several times to get the dynamic recrystallization. So, you can see that discontinuous dynamic recrystallization, as it is said, has a grain which is deforming and new necklace kind of microstructure are being developed, and with the further deformation it looks like this. Finally, the microstructure after the deformation may become like this. So, any kind of deformation that we do, any kind of forming process, rolling, forging and all, works on the principle of deformation and dynamic recrystallization, leading to a grain refinement by the process like this. In case of smaller grains, if you have smaller grains, then the dynamic recrystallization initially will look like this, right? That is just for you to know. A continuous dynamic recrystallization, on the other hand, could be viewed like if you have a grain boundary with dislocations, all sorts of dislocations, statistically stored dislocation present, and you can see that there is a lattice curvature present near the grain boundary. With the increase in the deformation, these dislocations are annihilated and at the same time arranged in form of like boundaries like this. These boundary densities are higher near the grain boundary, leading to formation of new nucleated grains at the grain boundaries, and the process includes the mechanism of bulging. You can see the boundary migration to those areas where the dislocation density is higher, as I shown, leading to a serrated kind of microstructure. This serrated kind of microstructure further deformed to form like this, and with further lattice rotations and various increase in the misorientation, form newly nucleated recrystallized grains, and the process is known as continuous dynamic recovery and recrystallization. Is I showed it in more detail in a few one class before. So, finally, the recrystallization texture. So, as I said, that deformation texture basically depends upon the amount of slip activity that is taking place in the material. This leads to increase in the dislocation density and all over, which leads to formation of certain deformation texture component. However, recrystallization leads to rotation of these components. Say for example, in case of BCC, it is said that there is a 25 to 30 degree tilt along the 110 axis. That is, if you have a sharp deformation texture, the recrystallized texture will have a 25 to 30 degree tilt along the 110 axis, right? If it is an FCC, then it may have a 30 to 40 degree tilt along the 111 axis, and it is an HCP, hexagonal closed packed material, it will have a 30 degree to 40 degree tilt along 0001 axis. With the more advent of new techniques and all, we know that, for example, I know very clearly that in HCP it is just the 30 degree rotation, it is exactly the 30 degree rotation. So, in case of recrystallization texture, the theory could be the theory of orientation dependent nucleation, or it could be the theory of orientation dependent growth. The recrystallization process is controlled by the plastic energy, that is the stored energy, right, or the plastic power. You will see that in some a research paper, it will be written plastic power. And the orientation of the recrystallization grain, orientation of the recrystallized grain shifts in order to go to a position having a minimum plastic energy. So, it goes, it shifts to a position to go to a lower stored energy. So, it has an orientation relation. If we look at the theory of recrystallization texture revolution by orientation of nucleation, oriented nucleation, it could be a classical nucleation type, a subgrain growth type, or a strain induced boundary migration type, right? So, the recrystallized texture based upon oriented nucleation could be same as the initial deformation texture. It happens very rarely. It is different from the deformation texture, but have a orientation relationship as I showed. It could have a random texture, and this texture could be a function of rate of nucleation, right? On the other hand, of course, it will be a function of initial orientation. So, if you have a sharp deformation texture, then you will have a sharp recrystallization texture, right? It's similar, you see that it is simply related to, for example, aluminium as an example have a high stacking fault energy, and therefore, its partials are very close. A certain heat assisted deformation will lead to glide and climb of edge dislocation, cross slip of screw dislocation, recovery by continuous dynamic recrystallization, and therefore, a rotation about a certain axis by a certain angle, which is related to this initial sharp deformation texture. It could be a function of grain boundaries. The grain boundaries, you know, have different types of energies, large energies. So, a grain boundary may have high energy or low energy. A low energy grain boundary could be a special one. You know that there are special grain boundaries known as coincidence height lattice boundaries, and this could be related. So, the nature of this CSL boundaries also will affect. So, the energy of the boundary and the mobility of the boundary also induce its effect on the recrystallization texture. So, nucleation has an effect, because you see while I talk about boundary, this means that nucleated grain has a boundary that is related to the parent grain, right? A boundary between the parent grain and the nucleated grain will be related, and this boundary could have an energy which is smaller, which has a more mobility, and maybe it could be a coincidence height lattice boundary, right? And this influences the recrystallized texture, because if you have a certain misorientation angular relationship with the parent deformed grain, then the recrystallized grain will have a certain texture which is recognizable if the deformation texture is sharp, right? Okay. Discontinuous recrystallization also have shown sharp recrystallization texture based upon initial deformation, sharp deformation texture. However, in many cases, like in magnesium and brass, discontinuous dynamic recrystallization have even showed formation of random texture. So, there in some cases it is also possible that the recrystallized dynamic recrystallized texture or the static recrystallized texture show no relation to the parent grain. And I will say that this may also happen in many cases, because if you see that when I am saying that there is a rotation, a tilt of 40 degrees along 111, there are 4 111 directions, right? Actually 8, if you say this, if you take both this direction, there are 8. So, you say there are 4 1 1 1 directions, and in each of this direction there could be a 40 degree tilt, and the tilt could be any side, right, this side or this side. So there are 8 possibilities, right? And if a recrystallized grains means if a deform, if a sharp deformation texture recrystallizes with 8 possibilities, and if these 8 possibilities are formed in equal amount, then the texture will be relatively weaker, right? So in many cases this may happen, okay? And remember that all these tilt boundaries that I am showing, this angular relationship along the 111001 and 110s, are basically formation of coincident site lattice boundaries. So on the other hand, there is theory of oriented growth. So see, it is the one which is based on the observation or specific rotation relationship associated with rapid grain boundary migration. Now, as I am saying that in most of the dynamic recrystallization or static recrystallization process occurs by a rotation about a certain axis for BCC, FCC and HCP, and if it is such, then this should be associated more with growth, grain growth, rather than on grain nucleation. Let us see that, see, if the recrystallization texture is determined by the original orientation of the nuclei having the highest growth rate in the deformed matrix. Say that there is a deformed structure, and in various places new grains have nucleated, and if these new grains have nucleated with all these 8 possible orientation along this 111 direction, then the nucleation is basically random, right? And if a growth of a certain orientation is occurring suppressing all the other orientation, then the recrystallized texture is basically because of the oriented growth, not because of the oriented nucleation, right? So you see, there is a very good example in case of aluminum and copper rolling. You see, the deformation texture mainly contains copper and brass component and S component maybe. If we have a small amount of recrystallization or maybe a deformation at a slight warm condition, then we may have gauss texture, right? A very faint cube texture. But if we keep it, if we anneal it for few seconds or few minutes, then we will find slowly the cube texture will start to generate, and finally there is only cube texture, and which supports the theory of oriented growth. Okay. Now, just for you, texture for the theory of oriented growth is basically depending upon the grain growth and the grain growth rate, and of course it should be 110 or 100, because you know the 100 is the most loosely packed planes, most loosely packed direction. So you just add one atom and it grows more, right? So the 100 will be most preferred direction for recrystallization, right? So it will suppress all other recrystallization and will form finally. So it also depends, the texture in this case also depends upon the initial strain present in the microstructure, the initial orientation, of course, because it is in relations. So it is the initial orientation which is very important, the alloy addition and impurities. You see, it also depends upon the alloy addition and impurities. If we add certain alloying element in a material, what happens? The first thing, if it is a fully solid solution, we will notice is a change in the stacking fault energy. If there is a change in the stacking fault energy, then the whole deformation mechanism will change, the recrystallization mechanism will is definitely going to change whole totally. So, solute addition affects, right. On the other hand, there could be dispersoid in the material, precipitations. These alloy addition and impurities may affect the material to obtain a texture which is totally different from the material without alloy addition. Like for example, if sometimes if a sharp recrystallization texture occurs in a material after alloy addition, it may become totally random texture. It may be ineffective sometimes. Sometimes initial material has a initial means the normal material without alloy addition may be having a random kind of texture, but after alloy addition it may get a sharp texture formation, and all kinds of thing for different materials has been reported in the literature. So, this is all being taught. This is also taught. So, you see the presence of second phase may lead to particle stimulated nucleation, right, and it may lead to pinning in the grain boundary, pinning of the grain boundary, you know, Jenner-Holloman pinning and all this effects will come depending upon the particle size, and all this will affect the texture evolution during the recrystallization process. Recrystallization affect the formation of ordered structure in the material, mostly in ceramics. Okay, this is all that I will say. That finally, regarding recrystallization is the secondary recrystallization. Secondary recrystallization inhibits the normal grain growth and promotes the abnormal grain growth. So, abnormal grain growth occurs when strong primary recrystallization texture is already present, okay. Particularly if their grain boundaries have lower misorientation. See, lower misorientation of grain boundaries means it is near to 15 degrees, but higher than 15 degrees, right, but not very high ones. So, it has lower energy and mobility, high mobility. Grains grown through secondary recrystallization often have a preferable crystal orientation. This texture will be different from the primary recrystallized texture. So, a presence of another very weak texture. Initially, after the recrystallization, there is a texture which is present, which is not very observable, but is present. So, when you annihilate more, that texture basically intensifies with the growth on those particular grains. Therefore, it is known as abnormal recrystallization or grain growth. So, you see in case of copper and aluminum, which is rolled and annealed, primary recrystallization initially cube texture forms. See, preferred cube texture forms, and then secondary recrystallization, the 38 degree rotation about the 111 axis forms, and this is known as the Kronberg-Wilson relationship. Okay. Why? Because this is the formation of coincidence site lattice boundary in the microstructure. Okay. So, the main factors which controls abnormal grain growth is texture, involves plastic deformation conditions and annealing, surface effects like abnormal grain growth is easier in thin sheets than in bulk material. So, you see that these abnormal grain growth are preferred in case of thin sheets. It depends upon the annealing temperature. So, if you have a high annealing temperature, abnormal grain growth takes place, and it depends upon the second phase particles. So, that is all regarding annealing texture and dynamic recrystallization.